Thank you, Tree. Exciting about Hugo House changing location. I know it's going to be a good change for the house and for the city. So I'm here to introduce and then to interview our guest tonight, Randall Kenan. Randall Kenan was born in Brooklyn, New York in 1963. He grew up in Chincapin, North Carolina, and graduated East Duplin High School in Beulahville, North Carolina. In his first novel, a big sister advises her brother to, quote, leave North Carolina, get out. Like the prodigal son, Kenan did, working at Knopf after college, and then teaching at Sarah Lawrence, Columbia, University of Missouri, University of Memphis, and Vassar. Also like the prodigal son, he returned to teach at his alma mater, University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, where he's currently an associate professor of English and comparative literature. He published his first novel, A Visitation of Spirits, in Kenan's writing has earned a number of awards, including a Guggenheim Fellowship, a Whiting Writers Award, a Sherwood Anderson Award, and the John Dos Passos Prize, among many others. His fiction has been compared to that of some late greats, including James Baldwin and, more recently, Gabriel Garcia Marquez. In it, I've found influences, whether actual or not, of Nathaniel Hawthorne's Young Goodman Brown, Sherwood Anderson's Winesburg, Ohio, Horton Foote's Young Man from Atlanta, The Incredible Hulk, Wonder Woman, Batman, Spider-Man. But nothing seems to penetrate his work more than the Bible. Almost all of his characters have read it, some preach it, and a select few have the audacity to question it. Most of all, Kenan's work explores the complicated landscape of family, of people who have known each other delightfully, if slightly too long. He sets us down in southeastern North Carolina, a town called Timms Creek. It's great to have him here. Please help me welcome back to Seattle and to Hugo House, Randall Kenan.
Good after evening. I was going to say good afternoon. Where I'm from, it's later than it is here. I am thrilled to be here. I'm always thrilled to come to Seattle. I was thinking now, it's been a while. I had the I think my Jewish friend would say the nachas to write about Seattle a while back, and it's there, isn't it? I love this institution and I'm always happy when they call. It is a hard time to be a vampire lover. I don't know what's going on. and I mean the old school vampire lovers. You got Twilight, you got True Blood, you got The Strain. I don't know what's wrong with these people. The vampires who can walk out in sunlight, vampires who have sensitive feelings. Vampirism has been stripped of all religious iconography and symbolism. It's just not fun anymore. One of my closest friends, who was a theologian and minister and prison chapel, Richard Wimberly, loved a book by Stephen King called Salem's Lot, which some of you may have known. It's his second novel, about vampires in a small town in Maine. And Richard particularly loved this scene where the priest, small town priest, encounters the big vampire Marlowe in the tunnel. And the priest whips out his cross. See, old school vampires, you show the cross to the vampire. And I think Barlow gives this talk, which is the longest peroration in the whole book by this monster. And he tells the priest that it's the symbol, it's not the symbol of God, it's the symbol of faith. And how the cross is only as strong as the faith. And Richard just loved this whole thing, you know, being a theologian, and he would work it into his sermons. And that's the whole thing about the vampire, these monsters, how connected they are to culture. And in the West, it's Christianity. In the East, I mean, Japan has some really terrifying monsters. And in terms of plot, the important thing is nemesis. And that's how we get the word. In Greek, the goddess Nemesis would appear. You're a hero. You're Theseus, you're Odysseus. You have to go out and do your hero thing. And the goddess Nemesis will drive up in a black hearse with her needle sword and stand in the hero's way. And you can't go back. You have to go forward. And so hence the tension, hence the plot. I blame all this foolishness on Anne Rice. She got the ball started for all this Twilight foolishness with Interview with a Vampire back in the late 70s. And what'd she do? She flipped the script. She told the story from the point of view of the vampire. And we have this impulse to humanize everything. The true power of the vampire myth is imagining the other. It is something ancient. It is something primordial. It should be unreasonable, implacable. It's something that comes out of our id. It is the very stuff of fairy tales, as Joseph Campbell and Bruno Bettelheim tells us. We want to humanize. Paradoxically, there's this ancient force, this mystery that we also want to honor. I remember that I, as a boy, at 14, got my first copy of Dracula from the Scholastic Readers Club. You know, they have little paperback books. I think it was like 75 cents. I still have my book. And I would read that book every fall when it started getting cold and the leaves turn. The leaves turn in Seattle, don't they? Yeah. Okay, so you know what autumn is. And in my mind, I would transform Eastern North Carolina into Romania. And here's the thing, the farmhouse, the farmland would become the mountains, and our little house would become Dracula's castle. And despite what my mama said, that nobody wanted me, I knew, because I cost too much to feed, that I knew that the vampire was lurking on the outside, the other. So what I want to talk about today is that other. And specifically, we can do the thing, the Gothic imagination. And so I want to talk about sense of place in the literary sense. And I want to talk about the Gothic notion of locus. Because I think that in this way that Gothic, the Gothic literature intensifies everything, that it tells us something about ourselves. That other is a way we define ourselves. And I want to talk about how that happens. And I want to look at some people, some writers who I think have used the Gothic to the best. We can learn some lessons from them. So this is a wonderful essay by Eudora Welty that I want to talk about. I use it a lot in my classes. For those of you who don't know Welty, she was a short story writer from Jackson, Mississippi. She was famous for her short stories. Before that, she was famous for photographs she took during the WPA, for the WPA, during the Great Depression. She won the Pulitzer Prize for her a perfect little novel called The Optimist's Daughter in 1973. She won the National Book Award in 1982 for her collected short stories. She was a wonderful short story collector, writer. Some said she was our Chekhov. And as irony would have it, her biggest book came at the end of her life, when she was already in her 80s. She gave a series of lectures, three lectures at Harvard, about the craft of writing. And they were collected in this one little book called One Writer's Beginning, and it became this huge national bestseller. Stayed on the bestseller list for over a year, and you know, sold more than all of her books together. This book, this essay that I want to talk about, is called Place in Fiction, and it was originally published in The Eye of the Story, a collection of her essays. And some of the quotes, some of the things, I've just pulled out a few things that I would like to, this is the opening of the essay. Place is one of the lesser angels that watch over the racing hand of fiction. Perhaps the one that gazes benignly enough from off to one side while others like character, plot, symbolic meaning, and so on are doing a great deal of wing beating about her chair, and feeling, who in my eyes carries the crown, soars highest of them all, and rightly relegates place into the shade. So she's doing something I think that intuitively a lot of people don't do, which is to think of place as important as character, plot, language, feeling, all those things. Several of the things that she talks about is how that place is the raw material of writing. We can do that thing. And that the goodness of writing itself comes out of how we make the world appear. That the novel from the start has been bound up in the local, in the real, the present, the ordinary day-to-day of human experience. She also says later, fiction is properly the work at work on the here and now, or the past made here and now. For in novels, we have to be there. And one of the things I love, and I'll come back to this, and I think this is central to what I'm fascinated about in the Gothic. Where does this mystery lie? Is it in the fact that place has a more lasting identity than we have, and we unswervingly tend to attach ourselves to identity? And you know, when you work with young people, it's you know, they're the center of their universe. And it's important sometimes, I think, to teach that we get our identity from this history that places have. I mean, we were talking earlier about football. How many people identify themselves by their local football team? Or in North Carolina, Lord have mercy, basketball. And what does that signify? The history, the memory, the associations. Fiction is a lie. I love that. Never in its inside thought, but always in its outward dress. And here, I want to pause because this is the crux of what I want to talk about. And you might think, well, what does this have to do with Dracula? But location pertains to feeling. Feeling profoundly pertains to place. Place in history partakes of feeling, as feeling about history partakes of place. It's a dense sentence. I know. I have it over my desk at home because I think it's important. Because we're talking about location, we're talking about history, and we're talking about feeling. Anything that happens to you somewhere. And what happens to you becomes a part of your history. And anything that happens to you, you have a feeling associated to it. And so that is really what we're talking about. We're talking about place. We're talking about where it happens. We're talking about what happens. We're talking about how that happening made you feel about it. Okay. My third favorite movie of all time, number one and two change and all the other ones, but I keep number three in the slot because, you know, that's I'm going to feel about it this way all the time. It's called The Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai in the Eighth Dimension. Oh, people, I'm so glad somebody knows it. Peter Weller, Jeff Goldblum, all those people. There's a scene, you might remember this, where Ellen Barkin is out in a room very much like this, and Buckaroo Banzai and his bands are playing, his band is playing, and she's crying, and Buckaroo knows it. And he gets him to put the spotlight on her, and there's Ellen Barkin in tears, her makeup is running. And he says, just remember, no matter where you go, there you are. So we think of place in terms of geography. Where in the world? I was a grown man, and my favorite TV show was Where in the World is Carmen Sandiego. Do you remember that show? I used to love that show. I miss Lynn Pigpen's Big Ben so much. But the idea of where is it, understanding geography as more than just coordinates on a map, but that every place has its identity, has its culture, and things. Things are a part of people's worlds, and characters define themselves by things. We're going to be doing a lot of things with things tomorrow in my class. And what has happened here, the history of a place. A thought exercise I like to give people a lot is think of one of the best moments of your life, and then think of the worst moment of your life, and to think about where it happened and how just thinking about that place makes you feel. And you'll begin to see the kind of connection I'm talking about when I'm talking about character and place and the power of place. Now, the central idea of the Gothic is the locus. And you might not see where I'm going with this, but just think of the haunted house. It is central to the story, and it has a character, and it becomes an active participant. Now, these are not Gothic stories, but I think these are stories that use place in this character mode that I'm thinking about. I don't know if you know John Galsworthy's Foresight saga. It's five novels in which he follows this one family, really two families, and there's this one house that's built in the first book that is sort of central to the plot. It's Robin Hill. It's sort of a house that's before its time. And the house throughout the series becomes this character in a way. Its meaning alters, it's altered. If I could see y'all, I'd ask you to raise your hands if you'd read it. But anyway, if you haven't read it, read it. One of Dickens' latest novels, Charles Dickens is still writing, y'all. I know you know. He's like Elvis and Tupac. He's still got books coming out. Bleak House is a wonderful estate, the Dedlock Estate. Which is the Bleak House of the title, which becomes his character. Beloved, Toni Morrison's Beloved, the very first paragraph describes this house. She just calls it by the house address, and you get the little ghost baby. And it's quintessential. Toni Morrison turns the haunted house on itself. And there's a wonderful novel by a writer who's been kind of forgotten, Elizabeth Colgate, but the shooting party takes place at this country estate, and the place becomes really central to what's going on. So the Gothic tradition, the Southern Gothic tradition, the American Gothic tradition, I think is really in many ways the human tradition. I'm really fat. That's why when I'm talking about it, because I'm fascinated by it. The first real Gothic book was The Monk by Matthew Gregory Lewis, published in 1796. They say he wrote it in a few weeks when he was 20, and it's the sinister tale of the monk Ambrosio, set in a Capuchin monastery in Madrid. And it is a tale of murder and incest and ambition, temptation, sexual obsession, sexual violation, sorcery, Satanism, ghosts, and Guilt. It is the most influential Gothic novel of all time. It sort of set the stage for what, it's not the first. The first Gothic novel was actually The Castle of Otranto by Horace Walpole, which was published in 1764. But certain things emerge from the Gothic. These stories about intrusion, stories of the supernatural, stories of horror, ghost stories. Somebody has come for a reason, and they want something. And you, as the protagonist, the main character, you can't really, you know, ignore it. I mean, it's like you. Who sits in their house when somebody's downstairs and, you know, just ignore it? You know, you have to do something. The wonderful thing, which I think we have learned, is that the status quo must be established. You have to have something to upset, you have to have something, you know, in order for it to be upset. You know, you have a good idea of what's coming at you, or at least what danger it represents. And the protagonist must confront whatever this thing is. And you either get rid of it or it gets rid of you. And that's sort of, in many ways, the structural conceit of the Gothic. But more importantly, and this is where we Americans have really absorbed so much from the Gothic, is there's going to be some iconography or subtext of, well, in the West, Christianity. And you think about the vampire, you have to be buried and dead for 3 days. Hello? There's some sexual repression. Dracula's a very sexy novel. And, you know, it's Twilight, that's nothing, you know. There is, there's the dark and the sinister, as with the monk. And not that we're talking about symbols here, but we're talking about those things, that those slimy things in our id. There's always a potential for melodrama, and that's where the monk goes. And the weird thing, if you ever get a chance to read the monk, you'll see when things get really dodgy, really dirty, the writing kind of pushes back. He knows how naughty he's being, and this started out being called the dark novel, the roman noir. But this, and so what we have, what we Americans did with it, and this is a lot. First is the Southern Gothic, and I come out of that tradition. That's one of the reasons I'm so interested in this. You know the Southern Gothic. You know Faulkner. I mentioned Welty before. You know, Lillian Hellman, and Tennessee Williams. He was. So you're in the Southland. You're haunted by the loss of the Civil War. I didn't lose the Civil War, by the way. I just want to be clear on that. You know, I won, I think. And then there's a preoccupation with family problems and family secrets. And if you think of Cat on a Hot Tin Roof, all of those Williams plays, the Faulkner novels, and that was the epitome of Southern Gothic. Now, American Gothic, which I'm really fascinated by, and probably has more to do with what you guys are dealing with and writing about, you have the dysfunctional family. It's usually tied to the land, again. This was really a genre born in the Midwest, a form born in the Midwest. It's really obsessed, whereas the South was dealing was obsessed with the purity of the female. The American Gothic is interested not only in masculinity but the failure of masculinity. And actually, there's some Southern writers who are really more American Gothic. You think of Daniel Woodrell, or the late Larry Brown, men and male sexuality, Protestantism and materialism. Think of Sam Shepard, think of Lewis, Sinclair Lewis, Steinbeck, Willa Cather, and the Pulitzer Prize winning novel by Jane Smiley, which was a retelling of King Lear. It has all of these elements there. The farm, the impotent male, and all those wonderful things. So what I wanted to do in the little time we have remaining is go through some of my favorite writers and look at some of their some passages from their work and see how they have taken the locus, and made it a character. And from that wonderful novel that I can't get out of my mind, Dracula. Then a dog began to howl somewhere in a farmhouse far down the road, a long agonized wail as if from fear. The sound was taken up by another dog, and then another, and another, till, borne on the wind, which now sighed softly through the pass, a wild howling began, which seemed to come from all over the country, as far as the imagination could grasp it, through the gloom of the night. Now, those of you who haven't read Dracula or seen one of the 50,000 movies made from it, Dracula is one of, I think he's one of the most recycled characters in movie history. Starting with Nosferatu, the German. Jonathan Harker is a solicitor who's being called by this old aristocrat from the late Holy Roman Empire in what we now call Romania, Transylvania. And the book is actually kind of postmodern because it's composed of letters and journals and things. So this is Jonathan writing back to his, or writing in his journal, and he's going to see the count. And I love this use of sound here, and how you get the sense of this, of this place. Here is the first encounter. When I went into the dining room, breakfast was prepared. My shadow. Oh well. But I could not find the count anywhere, so I breakfast alone. It is strange, as yet I have not seen the count eat or drink. He's a vampire. He must be a very peculiar man. Oh. After breakfast, I did a little exploring in the castle. I went out on the stairs and found a room looking towards the south. The view was magnificent. And from there, where I stood, there was every opportunity of seeing it. The castle is on the very edge of a terrific precipice. A stone falling from the window would fall 1,000 feet without touching anything. As far as the eye can reach is a sea of green treetops, which occasionally a deep rift where there is a chasm. Here and there are silver threads where the river's winding in deep gorges through the forest. But I am not in the heart to describe beauty, for when I have seen the view, I explored further. Doors everywhere, and all locked and bolted, in no place save for the windows and the castle walls is there an available exit. The castle is a veritable prison, and I am a prisoner. Stoker didn't go to Romania, but now you can go, it's apparently a huge tourist thing, to see the castle of Vlad Tepes. And, you know, it's kind of very similar. But for our purposes and for the purposes of the Gothic, the labyrinthine, doors with it, something we'll see again and again. The character of a place, and again, going back to this idea of echoing Christianity, and going back to, you know, that one great Gothic novel by Jane Austen that people don't realize is a spoof, Northanger Abbey. This is like a crypt. This is like the grave. These doors within doors, and it becomes very important in Gothic literature. The Count halted, putting down my bags, closed the door and crossed the room, opened another door, which led into a small octagonal octagonal room lit by a single lamp and seemingly without a window of any sort. Passing through this, he opened another door and motioned me to enter. It was a welcome sight, for here was a great bedroom, well lighted and warmed with another log fire, also added to lately, for the top logs were fresh, which sent a hollow roar up the wide chimney. The Count himself left my luggage inside and withdrew, saying before he closed the doors, "You will need after your journey to refresh yourself by making your," when I was in high school, I said, "your toilet," because I didn't know any better, "your toilet." So again, you see this the intimacy, this sense of, and you know, we don't know who or what Dracula is at this point, but there's certainly this sense of dread. And as Harker goes on, the house, the castle becomes a character. It becomes the locus of the vampire. And one of the things I love about this book is how that becomes turned on its head, because Dracula goes to London. He eats everybody on the ship on the way. He's a very hungry dude. He's got needs. But the ship becomes something of a ghost ship. It's very eerie, wonderful. And then the asylum where his henchman Renfield lives, almost an echo of the monastery in The Monk. And then the country estates where he goes butt wild with all those young women. So the locust follows him. The locust becomes him. Houses take on his character. In a less lurid vein, there's a wonderful Canadian writer who I think we can learn a lot from. Her name is Mavis Gallant. She, for those of you who may or may not know her, she sort of left Canada at a very young age, lived in France for most of her life. But she still continued to write about, she wrote about Europe, but she wrote about Canada a lot too. And I like teaching this story because it is one of the few truly omniscient stories. You have this, it's told from the point of view of God. And it becomes very important in this story because it's the story of this young woman, young girl, whose father has remarried, and she hates the stepmother. And the stepmother's, she's just, you know, a victim of circumstance. And this young girl just is so bitter and hateful. And so the young woman, newlywed, goes to this boarding school where the daughter is kept. She needed to placate her. And she goes and takes out her friends for tea. And the beauty of the omniscience that Gallant uses here is that at the tea, she gets to go into every character's head. And you see what the stepmother is thinking. You see what this little bitter girl is thinking. You see what all her friends are thinking. And in all this external drama, and it's so poignant, there's this one little scene where this little girl at the table, who's almost being ignored, is thinking about all the troubles her parents are having at home. So it's very, very masterful. But look how Gallant uses place here. That year, it began to rain on the 24th of May. Remember, this is an omniscient narrator. It's not held by time. It's not held by what you or might I know. It knows everything. That year it began to rain on the 24th day of May, a holiday still called some 30 years after her death, Queen Victoria's birthday. It rained, this was Canada, until the middle of June. She has a very dry wit, Mavis. The girls kept indoors, exercising listlessly in the gym, quarreled over nothing, and complained of headache. Between showers, they walked along spongy gravel paths, knocking against spirea bushes that suddenly spatter them with water and white. It was the last lap of the term, the dead period, between the end of exams and the start of freedom. Handicrafts and extra art classes were improved to keep them busy, but it was hopeless, glooming over their desks. They quarreled, dreamed of summer, wrote plaintive letters, Their raincoats were suddenly hot and heavy, their long black stockings scratchy and damp. You can't think of these girls without thinking of them in a place. She situated them, and even their body's reaction, the sweatiness, the scratchiness, is directly related to this rainy, wet place. Coming into the flagged entrance hall, Mrs. Holland, that's his stepmother, was daunted by the chilly gloom. She stared at the row of raincoats hanging from the pegs, the somber portraits of businessmen and clergymen on the walls. Governess trained, she considered herself hopelessly untutored, and attached to the smell of dying coats, an atmosphere of learning. And on the next page, in point of fact, a school had never been an abbey. Each of its clammy stones had been quarried in North America, and the architectural ragout was deliberate. It was intended to provide the pupils with character and background otherwise lacking in the new continent. As for the fruit importer who gave the money, the size of his portrait had to do with the size of his endowment. The endowment had been enormous. The school was so superlatively uncomfortable that it cost a fortune to run. And do I have, okay, yeah. So I think the first two are pretty clear. This is the end. And I think, again, she exploits the omniscience so wonderfully that the girl, Ruth, and her stepmother, after that tea, see each other. From an upstairs window, Ruth watched Mrs. Holland make her way to the car. They had all made mistakes, Ruth thought. She wondered if she would ever care enough about anyone to make all the mistakes those around her had made during the rainy day tea with Mrs. Holland. She breathed on the window, idly drew a heart, smiled placidly, and let it fade. And after all that drama, everything comes down to that we've all done that, drawing that the moisture in the glass. And this is, you know, it's a very physical thing, but this is, again, the use of place in the way that I'm talking about, an awareness of the situation and the connection between location, history, and feeling. I'm trying to think, do we have time for one more? This is a great novel, I think, a curious novel. The great critic Dennis Donahue said it's the strangest novel he'd ever read. In the Western Hemisphere, I think. It's by the great Mexican writer Carlos Fuentes, and it's a ghost story. It takes place in Mexico City. Fuentes is famous for making Mexico City his Yucnapatalpa, his Jefferson, Mississippi. And this is a story written in the second person, and it's a story of a young man, a young translator, who needs a job, and he's reading in the newspaper that this somebody wants a military hero's letters made into a publishable thing. He goes to this place that we're going to read about, and he meets this older, this very delicate, fragile, I should say, older woman who is the widow of this military man. And she engages this guy. And of course, she lives in this very gothic mansion in the middle of Mexico City. And he, on the way out, he meets this beautiful young lady. Throughout the book, the old woman and the young woman are never in the same room at the same time. Ooh. I'll let you figure out. It's surprising to know that anyone lives on Don Calise Street. You always thought, remember it's in second person, you always thought that nobody lived in that old corner of the city. You walk slowly trying to pick out the number 815 in that conglomeration of old colonial mansions, all of them converted into repair shops, jewelry shops, shoe stores, drug stores. The numbers have been changed, painted over, confused. A 13 next to a 200, an old plaque reading 47 over a scrawl in blurred charcoal. Now 924, you look up at the second stories. Up there, everything is the same as it was. The jukeboxes don't disturb them. The mercury streetlights don't shine in. The cheap merchandise on sale along the street doesn't have any effect on that upper level, on the baroque harmony of the carved stones, on the battered stone saints with pigeons clustered on their shoulders, on the latticed balconies, the copper gutters, the sandstone gargoyles, on the greenish curtains that darken the long windows, on that window from which everyone draws back when you look at it, you gaze at the fanciful vines carved over the doorway, then lower your eyes to the peeling wall and discover 815, formerly 69. So one of the things that I love about Fuentes is that he respects the many layers in Mexico, going back to before the Aztecs, bringing in the Aztecs, Spanish rule, the French rule on top of the Spanish rule, back to Spain, to independence, and everything that happened out there. So his Gothic, his sense of place, his sense of history, the sense of feeling that comes out of the history is very rich. It's almost Baroque in many ways, but the Gothic comes natural to him, and I think this is a great example of how, and it's not the locust, and he, even in his first novel, Where the Air is Clear, the locust is really the city, more so than any place. We don't have time. I was going to give you a novel that has sort of fallen out of favor, Gloria Naylor's Brewster Place, and it was a collection of short stories, all often thought of as a novel, and it takes place in a place, and I was going to show you, you can look at it at your leisure, Women of Brewster Place by Gloria Naylor, how she uses this place as a character, and also, and I probably should bring us to the end. I promise you, The Ship of Fools, and there's this wonderful novel by the great short story writer, Catherine Ann Porter. She took like 40 years to write it. She was acclaimed as a short story writer, and she had this one novel in her that she couldn't finish. And it was based on a trip she took in just before the Great War to Europe on a ship. And the metaphor, there's a tale that goes back to the Middle Ages about a ship of fools, souls that are lost. And I think this is a beautiful example. For those of you who might know the novel, it became a huge bestseller. It was made into a movie with Simone Signore. And I think in many ways you can see that she has made the ship the locust for these souls. And if you think about that iconography, the monster, who's the monster in this book? Well, as I said, it was before the war, and everyone's talking about those Nazis. So I think it's a great example of, and so to reprise the things from Miss Welty, that we, place has a more lasting identity than we do. And we unswervingly attach ourselves to identity. And if we think of start thinking of our characters as being connected to place, we will be moored, so to speak. And location pertains to feeling. Feeling profoundly pertains to place. Place in history partakes of feeling, as feeling about history partakes of place. Location, feeling, history, place. Of course, it is not imperative to create a place without the force and elements and haunting presence of a character. You don't have to. So many of our great writers have eschewed this device this technique, this obsession, this clearly is what I have, this way of viewing the world. For many writers, a house is just a house. A farm is just a farm. A graveyard is simply where you plant dead people. However, for some of us, the place is the thing, not so much as the play. For us, land is always haunted and full of memories and culture and identity. So I'm going to stop there and thank you so very much.
Thank you, Randall Kenan. We're going to take a 10-minute intermission, after which we'll continue talking about place, and I and you will be able to ask him questions. Randall Kenan, thanks again for the talk about place. It seems a little bit even like a preview of the class you're teaching tomorrow. For this WordWorks, you suggested a sense of place as a topic. And as I was reading your books, I was a little bit surprised that you suggested this, in part because your fiction is not necessarily, it's not really overtly placey. And I'm thinking of a book called Winesburg, Ohio by Sherwood Anderson, in which he has like a little map drawn and he talks about where the post office is and where the creek is and the two sort of intersecting streets. And some other, you know, when I think of writing place, I think automatically, okay, we're going to describe the landscape in great detail. And I don't see you doing that in your fiction. It doesn't have a lot of floor description. Your books don't have maps in the beginning. So can you describe your approach to writing place in fiction?
When I think of maps, I think of Tolkien. I think all of those books had a map at the beginning. No, and I think Faulkner had maps. I didn't have the energy, I think, to do that. But I guess I didn't really see the benefit of it. But yeah, as I said before, the place is really about where something happened and how you inhabit the place at that moment, and then how place evokes history. I mean, I'm spending a lot, my grandfather, we just had to place him in assisted living, and you know, it was 101 years of memory, you know. And so I remember driving him to, you know, I drove him to the place, and you know, every place along the road, I mean, he had been a dry cleaner. He owned a dry cleaning establishment, and he drove his own a truck, and so he had been down these roads countless times. So that to me is representative of how I think of place, memories, and how those memories evoke feelings. Mm. And what you want to do as a writer is engender some sense of that feeling into your reader. Is an instrument to do that.
I want to look at one of a passage from your book, A Visitation of Spirits. Are these microphones okay? Yeah. Okay. Oh, is that mine? Oh, okay. Okay. Thank you. So this is from the beginning of your novel, Visitation of Spirits, a couple pages in, and we're still getting to know the town and the landscape. As you do a few times in this novel, you describe a process.
toward describing this place. And for those of you who don't know, Randall Kenan's first two books, A Visitation of Spirits and Let the Dead Bury Their Dead, this is the novel, this is a book of short stories, both set in the same town, fictional town called Timms Creek, North Carolina. I wonder if you were willing to read this and then talk a little bit about it, how it kind of introduces us to Timms Creek.
Oh, okay.
Can you see it?
I can.
Okay.
I didn't realize I was going to read it to the wall. Do you recall the two or three women who stand out in the middle of the field, a field now planted in winter rye grass that has just begun to peek from the stiff earth? They stand about the hole the men dug the day before, a hole as deep and as wide as a grave. The women stand there at its edge. One holds a huge intestine that looks like a monstrous hairless caterpillar. She squeezes the thing from top to bottom, time after time, forcing all the foul matter down and out into the hole. And when the bulk is enough, through the second woman pours steaming hot water dipped from a bucket into one end of the fleshy sack as the other woman holds it steady. She sloshes the gut gently back and forth like a balloon full of water until she finally slings the nasty gray water into the reeking hole in the ground. All the while they talk, their faces placid, their fingers deft, their aprons splattered with fecal matter, the hole sending steam up into the air like a huge cooking pot, reeking, stinking. But you've seen this, haven't you? My apologies to all the vegans.
Thank you. I love this passage. It's a hog killing. And toward the end of the novel, there is a chicken killing, a description of that process. And then toward the very end, I don't want to give anything away, there's another description of another killing. I just want... this is...
so murderous.
Wow. Not a ton of adjectives. Again, not a broad sweeping description of landscape. Can you talk about the use of process, like this process, to describe? Help us orient ourselves where we are, by saying what's happening.
Well, as you pointed out, the book is bookended by two. A hog killing and putting in tobacco, and those are the two really iconic events for this community. And it also, I mean, I think when I wrote this book, I realized that they were fast going away. People don't do these things anymore. You don't have hog killings. Tobacco is completely mechanized. So I think the first one is, the last one is Requiem for Tobacco, and I forgot what this is. Look, anyway, I think it's the Advent.
Yeah, beginning of the end.
Beginning of the end. That's there you go. So I wanted to particularize it, capture it, and the specifics from memory, and the rhetorical device, which seems really cheeky now. You know, the bringing in the questions. And so much of it, again, rhetorically, is set up as a question. You've seen this, you know this, it does seem rather. I'm a cheeky person, so that's okay. But when I talk about place, I mean that this defines that place. You couldn't kill it on the street of Seattle. You couldn't kill it on a ship. I guess you could kill on a ship, but it'd be really messy. So, you know, it happens in this very specific place. This happens to define this place, you know, a place where you raise and kill hogs, where these people go about their business. So, I think it very much is involved with place and those things, history, feeling.
Yeah, and the thing, I mean, what I see a lot is, you said about tomorrow's class, I wrote it down here, we're going to do a lot of things with things tomorrow. I like that. And here we see, you know, when I think of place and description, I think of adjectives. But But here we see just a lot of nouns that are doing the work of describing place. The huge intestine.
I used huge twice there, I just noticed that.
Yeah, is that, would you have edited that
out? I would
out
have edited it, yeah. I was like, damn, I didn't want to do that.
But I'm just
even
struck.
Even though Fowler says it's okay to do that. I mean, we're, people get too hungry.
I'm just struck by the number, you know, you're using nouns and verbs, basically, to describe, rather than what is really traditionally the descriptor, the adjective, which I find really interesting. And then your metaphors, of course, noun to noun, looks like more like a monstrous, hairless caterpillar. And I love the woman's nonchalance when they're doing this. It's a really beautiful passage.
Well, thank you. And that is really reportage. I mean, I saw that so much growing up that...
Does something like that ever, you know, you saw it so much growing up, but then you have to make the connection that someone like me, who's from from a city, did not see that growing up, and that this may not have been fascinating to you anymore, but it is fascinating to other people. Is that sort of a leap you have to make in order to say, okay, I'm going to go ahead and write this, even though it's kind of, you know, I've seen it so many times, it's almost mundane to me. Is that like a little leap that you have to make as a fiction writer to say, oh, but yet, for someone else, this is really interesting?
Well, I hope I have, I mean, God, it would really bum me out to think that there are many mundane passages in my stuff. I mean, I think, you know, Faulkner said you want to try to make the extraordinary ordinary and the ordinary extraordinary. And so, you know, if anything I'm writing about, I hope I can excite the same feeling that I'm having about it. And even if it's not, you know, it's not somebody being shot with a gun or whatnot. I mean, I've read the great writer, she's from the West Coast, M.F.K. Fisher, could write about cooking and food in the most exciting ways. So it's not so much of the thing, it's how we perceive the thing.
And this
thing again.
There it is, yeah. And this would be making the extraordinary ordinary, is that right? In this passage? The other way. The other way, really. To me, it's extraordinary.
See, that's interesting.
And you're playing it down.
See, that's interesting because, you know, every December you kill hogs.
Right.
You know, I mean,
and that's ordinary. World. Yeah.
So it was ordinary.
Yeah.
So it was ordinary.
Interesting.
So I was trying to make it interesting. But I guess that's the tension.
Yeah.
That's
I mean, it's making me think what in my life is ordinary to me that I could write that would be extraordinary to someone. I'm not thinking of anything.
And you don't want to write about everything.
Right.
I think, you know, what's that dude, that Norwegian guy? Knausgaard. My struggle, he needs some editing. TMI.
Who is it?
Carl Uwe Knausgaard. Oh. My struggle. It's like a five or six volume autobiography.
Oh. Yeah. Oh yeah, yeah. I remember seeing it because it had the same title as a German book.
Yeah.
Yes. That's right.
Mein Kampf.
Can we go? Yeah, can you talk about this place a little bit?
Oh my God,
does that look familiar?
Yeah.
What is this? I mean, we live here in the Northwest, and this is southeastern North Carolina. You can see that blue line is the South Carolina border.
Does it look dramatically
different? It does not.
I don't know. I can't see it with your eyes.
Tell us a little bit about what this place is like. You grew up in this place. You write about this place, and there's Fayetteville, and part of the novel, Visitation of Spirits, takes place there. What's going on? Can you talk?
At Kenansville, yeah.
Talk a little bit about this place.
This is down east North Carolina. The east is the coastal plains. You can see from the bottom, there's water on the other side. So it's on the opposite of where you guys are, a little farther down south. It's actually on the same latitude as, I think you come around Los Angeles. We're farther east than anywhere on the East Coast because of the Outer Banks. there's been a lot of down there by Wilmington, all the way up through. If you see that road that leads up Jacksonville, I'm somewhere on that highway. And it's the only place on the East Coast where Venus flytraps occur naturally. They're now naturally protected. We have a lot of hogs. They're more hogs than people. In my home county, Duplin, we once had a billionaire. He's now only worth a few hundred million dollars, who made his fortune off hog production. He turned it into a sort of a factory kind of thing. It used to be very heavily dependent on tobacco. That was a huge cash crop. But now it's pork and poultry. And it's the governor once said, if you slice everything east of I-95 off from everything west of it, you'd have it made it its own state. You'd have the poorest state in the union. So. I don't know if that gives you
Wow. Thank you.
So closer to the coast before?
Yes.
Really?
Yes. We have hurricanes. That's
interesting.
We have hurricanes.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we can't develop. I mean, people keep building things, but it gets torn. God takes it back.
Does anyone know what celebrities from Wilmington, North Carolina? Michael Jordan is from Wilmington, North Carolina. Yeah, it's an interesting part of the country. And I'm also, we spoke about Lumberton as well. If anyone knows that movie, Blue Velvet, that's where Lumberton, that's where it was set in Lumberton, also near Cape Fear is in this area as well. I wanted to ask, where were you when you wrote these two books? Did you write them kind of in tandem? Did you kind of write the short stories as you were writing the novel? So those are my first two questions. Where were you?
I was in New York. I was working for Random House, Knopf. And I had been in New York for not that well. I was only 26, so how long could I have been in New York? Or 25 when I finished it. The title story of Let the Dead Bury Their Dead actually had been a part of A Visitation of Spirits. The novel is, to be all fancy about it, a triptych, you know, the three parts. And I had originally, I used another word, I forgot what it was for. Diptych? I had originally wanted it to be four parts. But I couldn't quite. What is it?
Quantum or something.
Is it?
I don't know. I'm making it up.
I think it's Greek, not Latin. That's why I can't remember. I don't count well in Greek. But yeah, I couldn't make the four work, and it felt unwieldy. A three tripart worked better. So I just sliced out that story, but it seemed to work well on its own. So it became the novella.
And so, okay, so you wrote some of them, partially you wrote them together. And mm-hmm. The other question I had is it helped to be away from a place in order to capture it? So you were writing these in New York, you're writing about this place in North Carolina.
It gives you freedom. It gives, you aren't bound up by the actual, and your imagination can roam a little bit. And I also think there's this sort of, I don't know, pining seems too short, but there's sort of a sharpness of the memory, because you have to recreate it, and again the memories go into that. So I think you can more easily access your emotional content, mm-hmm. And that can help. And that's what you're really looking for when you're using prose to recreate the emotional sense of the place. If you're there, you know it's much more complicated.
Can we? I wonder if we can. I said I wouldn't do this, but can we fast forward to, I think the second to last slide? Yes. This. I wonder if anyone can tell me where this is from. The poem is always in your hometown, but you have to a better chance of finding it in another. Not just any town will do. Though you've seen it before, it must be a town you've lived in all your life. You must take emotional possession of the town, and so the town must be that, for personal reasons I can't understand, you feel is your town. In this town, it is easy to turn the gas station attendant into a drunk. Back home, it would have been difficult because he had a drinking problem. Does anyone know where this is from? Yes, Richard Hugo, the triggering town. His book on writing poetry. Does that strike a chord with you? What do you think about that?
Yeah, I can identify with that. I can agree with a lot of it. I think we were talking earlier about North Carolina writers and the one that all the prose writer that everyone kind of bows down to is Thomas Wolfe. And there's a cyclical thing with Wolfe. Thomas Wolfe, Look Homeward Angel. Look Homeward Angel. You Can't Go Home Again. And he wrote about Asheville, North Carolina, in the mountains. And the cyclical thing is that some people say it was just a reportage, transcribing what happened in the town. And then you see that he changed a lot. I mean, his imagination was in gear. But it's exactly that tension. And he was in Brooklyn when he was writing that. The sense of fidelity to reality, and then changing, taking command of characters and stories to best benefit the story. And I think that when you're writing based on actual experience, that is always a tension that people have.
I wonder if after you had begun A Visitation of Spirits sometime when you were in the process, did you then go home and kind of look around and see, do I have it right? Or did you kind of see things anew that you then took back to New York? Was that part of your process? Or was it all just writing from a distance?
Well, you think there are things you get wrong. The things you're glad you got wrong. The things you missed. And the thing about having your wonderful, and we talk about Faulkner, but Balzac did it before him, and John Edgar Wideman has done it, and Fuentes, and Garcia Marquez, who got it from Faulkner. I mean, it's a thing that. But when you have your own little place, you're at once bound by it, and then you can rearrange it. So, I mean, you own it, so you can do what you want with it. So I think the more you do that, the more you write about this imaginary place and acknowledge it as being its own thing, then, it becomes, I don't think of Tim's Creek as Chinkapin. And the things in Tim's Creek that don't exist in Chinkapin, the things in Tim's Creek that once existed in Chinkapin that don't exist anymore. I think the more you have possession of it, the more it becomes its own thing. And I don't regret those those sorts of things.
It's interesting that earlier you talked about layers of a city, and that all kind of cities having these layers, and how the last part of this novel is called Requiem for Tobacco, and it ends, I'd like to read just the last couple lines because I think they're really, really interesting. I thought this didn't look familiar. There we go. It is good to remember that people were bound by this strange activity, tobacco farming, this activity that put food on their tables, clothes on their backs, and sent their young ones to school, bound by the necessity, the responsibility, the humanity. It's good to remember, for too many forget. And I think about how Seattle is layered as well. I'm not from Seattle, but I've been here for a couple of years, and my wife and I went on the ghost tour and the underground tour, and how there was, there is that kind of underground layer that we're sort of seem to be trying to preserve a little bit. That forgotten layer, I think, is really interesting. And it's a relatively new city, but these older cities must have layers and layers and layers. Interesting to think about that when thinking about writing place, sort of what came before.
And I think every place, especially, it's all relative. I'm reading the Plantagenets now, by I forget his name, but every inch of England has, you know, goes back to before the Romans and all that. And I think it's easy for us to get conned into thinking that, oh, well, it's only 200 or 150 or some cases, you know, less than 100 years of history. But some places are better at boosting that, and some of that's a lie. But I think every place has those layers, whether it's remembered or forgotten, but it's there to be discovered, which I think is very exciting.
Mm-hmm. And if you're writing about a fictional town, maybe that gives you some leeway to create layers, I guess.
Well, you can be influenced by whatever. I mean, the town, Thames Creek, that novella, Let the Dead Bury Their Dead, was inspired by the idea of maroon societies. I studied with this wonderful historian, Sonia Stone, who was one of the first members of SNCC. And I took this class with her, and she talked about maroon societies, runaways, something during before emancipation, where slaves would sneak off to forests or mountains or swamps and start their own little, you know, communities. And that just captured my imagination for some reason. And so, because I was fictional, I could make up the fact that this town got its start as a maroon society. And, you know, it was plausible. It was a lie, but it's... and since then, more and more anthropologists have been finding these maroon societies all around where I'm writing about. So, you know, it was just a happy accident.
Yeah. I have a few more questions for you, but I wanted to open it up to questions from the audience. So I can't see you all very well. Oh, there we go. Thanks, that's a lot better. Any questions out there at this point?
So for instance, the example that you just gave, poets are great for the muse, but you know, all writers kind of tap into their unconscious at a different point. Even if you're reaching back to memory, and you're writing about something that you actually experienced, it often is taken to a different level by something subconscious, unconscious, imagination, whatever word you want to put to it. Can you say anything about the role of that, you know, in your writing, or in any writer's writing?
I'm a champion of the imagination. I think it's gotten a bad rap in recent time. I love it when I go, I'm on a plane or on a train or, you know, talking to somebody. I don't know why they always work in insurance or something. And what do you do? Oh, I'm a college professor. Oh, what do you teach? I teach writing. Oh, do you write? Oh, yeah, well, I've written. What do you write? Fiction. Oh, you, well, I said, I don't really read fiction. I like to read real things.
Yeah.
You know, we've kind of forgotten what the power of the imagination is. All of these artifacts from great imaginations that have taught us things about ourselves. And I think that some people think that imagination, you just make up stuff. And even someone as fanciful as Tolkien, I mean, think of the rigor that went into creating, and he knew Icelandic sagas backwards, forwards, and his imagination was shaped by that. So I think imagination for it to be engaged has to be informed on one level by real world experiences, on the other level by, you know, the human logic, the logic of, you know, the human heart. And those things combined. There's many things. Willa Cather said you know everything you need to know to be a writer by the time you're 5 years old because you've experienced all the important things that you're ever going to experience. You've experienced loss, you've experienced love, you've experienced fear, all those things. And that, you know, I think is what shapes the imagination.
Toward, oh, is there a question up here? No. Toward that, I wonder if there's, for these two books, did you research the area? Did you research a lot? Or was your experience living in North Carolina kind of your running start without research?
I had a lot of baggage you know, I knew a lot already, but I love researching, so it's almost like, you know, a dare to see how to get me to stop. And yeah, and it's endless. And the thing about research, and I even with my fiction writers, I take them to the library and I get them to talk to an actual reference librarian who knows what they're talking about. Because there's this weird thing happening that people say, oh, I'm in, where is Google here? Google's down.
Okay. It's in the bay. Yeah.
They think that everything worth knowing can be found in Google.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Wikipedia.
Yeah, Wikipedia, Google. I'm like, oh, baby, no. I mean, there's just so much to know, and it's inexhaustible. And so I try to, you know, sort of, I want to intimidate them, in fact, by, you know, just the warehouse of knowledge that we've only cracked. And, you know, and you could, you know, it's a great, I also want them to be excited, as I am, by, you know, there's just so much to write about, so much to, that can inform our work. It's a life's work.
Speaking of that, are you, you're now working on a novel and a short story collection. And I'm kind of wondering, well, first, can you talk to us about them? What are they, where are they, dare I say, set? what are they about generally? And the other question I have is, are you writing them in tandem? Are they related? And if so, are you kind of, are you springing off of these two? Are you learning anything from having written these two? What are you kind of keeping in mind?
Well, the stories have mostly all been written and published, and you know, they just haven't been collected. And almost all of them are as from people are in Tim's Creek or people are from Tim's Creek. The novel is set in. I tell people it's set in North Carolina and New York, which it is, the two main events. It's a story about a kidnapping, these two rich boys, one black, one white, by this group of civil disobedience, and sort of it follows them, you know, from being 10 into their 30s. But it also happens all over North America because the group calls themselves the Army of Perambulating Prestidigitators. And so...
What does that mean?
What does it mean? Yeah. The Perambulating Prestidigitators.
Walking...
The walking musicians.
Oh. Yeah. Thank you.
The APP for short. So yeah, they wind up in all sorts of. They wind up in Bellingham.
That's where I live.
Yeah.
Very interesting. Yeah, that's really interesting. So, and I wonder if you can also give us a preview of the class tomorrow. What are you going to talk about? Actually, you spoke a little bit about it. And it's got the same title as your talk. Anything else we should know about the class?
Well, we're going to go. We're going to look at on a more minute level at. The influence of place on character, and how identity is.
Oh yeah, that was a separate discussion, but we can keep. It's a nice image. We can keep it up.
It's very much place.
We can talk
very
about
placey,
it.
As you say.
Yeah. Yes. We can talk about it. I'm sorry.
That's quite all right. So yeah, we're going to talk about how you define location, feeling, and history, and play with that.
And write. As well.
Yes, yes,
yeah.
Yes. So
cool.
In class writing exercises.
Cool.
And sharing.
Sharing. That's great. So the class is 10 to 1 tomorrow here at Hugo House. Other questions from the audience?
I didn't quite catch where is your setting, east or west of the highway you were talking about? The hurricane.
East.
But in what ways do you use those?
Yeah, if you live in eastern North Carolina, you're aware of hurricanes. I mean, we have hurricane season, and you take it very seriously. And the turn of this sounds crazy, but at the turn of the century, we had it was 1 year where we had several storms right back to back, Floyd, and it really decimated. I mean, it wasn't as bad as Katrina, but we had certain towns that were flooded off, out, you know, washed away, forests that were leveled because it was also the wind as well as the water. My hometown was, you know, there are pictures of, you know, people on boats going through. And the wonderful North Carolina writer, Alan Gerganis, he's written several things about that, and he has a new book, Lost Local Souls, or I always call it Lost Souls. And he writes about, you know, a town. He's from the same part of the country that was, you know, flooded, and how people dealt with that.
I think that would remove some of that history and texture as well.
Remove?
Remove the history and texture when a hurricane comes through.
Well, I mean, it's not just as with New Orleans. I mean, a lot remains. And I don't know if anyone, I mean, people moved their homes, but they didn't leave the area in mass. So I mean, everything was completely wiped off the basically.
So, taking off from that is a great question. The concept of you know, the hurricane as something totally outside of human control, and how huge its impact can be. I'm just curious how you think that's affected you personally, as a writer, having grown up someplace with that kind of fury.
Well, I mean, I think a part of Protestantism, and, you know, all these people are Baptists largely, there's that whole idea of predestination and, you know, in the will. So, I mean, I think a lot of the characters I write about, what, you know, sort of, it's in the hands of God and all that sort of thing. But again, I think there's a whimsy, in a way, to how these things, I mean, you can go, we haven't had a hurricane for 2 years, and so, I mean, there's you know, a spin of the wheel kind of sense to it as well.
I was just gonna say, I lived in North Carolina for 20 years, and I lived on the opposite side of the state.
You lived in the mountains.
I lived in Winston-Salem.
Oh, Winston-Salem.
In Greensboro, so yeah. I know quite well the area you're talking about, and what a hurricane does is. And it doesn't just affect the eastern side of the state. Everyone is aware throughout the state of what a hurricane can do. But it's different because we got all the tornadoes. And so you just knew that twice, you know, every year, what, April to November, this is what this is going to be like. And it really does change how you look at weather, you know, how you look at your house. And so what she was saying, well, it would destroy the history. Well, we had a hurricane that came through Winston-Salem and tore up this park that had been there for like 350 years. We were just throwing trees at like matchsticks, and then got to the edge of the park, backed up, and just took out the rest of the park. But everybody still remembered that the park was there and how long it had been there. And it's just that history is still there. You know, incidentally, did not hit the apartment building that I actually lived in, which was right on the edge of the park. And so you have this constant, I don't know if you guys, because on the, you're down in that area, but it's kind of a fear. It's a fear that, like, it's like being in earthquake country. You know it could potentially happen, and you know it's always in the back of your mind, but you go, you know, you live daily life. That's a little bit different because you know every year that the potential is always there to have your home, and it does inform you in some ways.
I mean, one of the oldest, it was the oldest black town founded by blacks, lived in by blacks, was in that part. It was called Princeville, and it was destroyed. During that flood I told you about. But, you know, they've just put markers down. There's talk of rebuilding it. So yeah, I mean, it hasn't been eradicated, even though physically it kind of was washed away. But, so, yeah.
Yeah, I was
So yeah. Yeah, I mean, it is part of, it's a character. I don't want to say character building. That sounds too Oprah. but it does become a part of your character and your person.
I wonder if we feel that in Seattle. One of my friends wrote a, I remember her writing a poem about, she lives in West Seattle and she drives into the city every day and she watches Mount Rainier and she's thinking, don't blow right now. I wonder if we have that, I don't know, in the back of our heads at some point. Pretty.
Dude, how many, well, Mount St. Helens, how many, was it 30?
Yeah.
81? 80?
Yeah, so, I mean, the people, 35. There are people who are grown who have no recollection of what that could be like.
But it's a different awareness when something happens cyclically, mm-hmm. and you know to be on the watch for it. You know the feeling in the air.
Yeah.
You know, it's a barometer. I mean, as opposed to it happening at larger intervals.
Yeah.
It's so much easier for people to lose that awareness, I think. So one of the gifts of an area like that is that the awareness is keen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is.
We have time for one or two more questions. All right, thank you. Actually, I have one more quick question for Randall Kenan. We were playing Trivial Pursuit the other night with my in-laws, and nobody got this question, but I thought Randall Kenan might. It's the 80s edition, and the category is wild card. And here's the question, nobody got it. Who comes directly after Scotty in the Enterprise's chain of command?
After Scotty, it has to be the chick off her Sulu. It's Kirk, Spock, Scotty. I'm going with Sulu, helmsman.
The answer is Sulu.
Ah!
Good night. Thank you, Randall Kenan.